Today, we are often told that molecules turned into men over billions of years through the same kinds of material processes that are going on now, like supernova explosions, genetic mutations, and natural selection. We are told that this is not a belief, but an irrefutable fact of science. The Genesis account of how God created the heavens and the earth, and all of the different kinds of creatures, including the first human beings, is often dismissed as a myth. So let us examine the question for ourselves: creation or evolution? Which is the more scientific explanation for the origins of man and the universe? Let's begin by defining science. Science can be defined as the intellectual and practical activity encompassing the systematic study of the structure and behavior of the physical and natural world through observation and experiment. According to this definition, which is more scientific, the divine creation of all things or molecules to man evolution? Let us begin with so-called stellar evolution. According to God's revelation in Genesis, as understood in His church from the beginning, God created all of the first stars by an act of His divine will. According to evolutionary speculation, gas condensed to form the first stars, and this process of star formation has been going on for billions of years to form hundreds of billions of stars. But this process of star formation from clouds of gas has never been observed. In the words of PhD astronomer Carlos Frank at Cambridge University, quote, "We don't understand how a single star forms, yet we want to understand how 10 billion stars form." During the Exodus, God created a pillar of fire by night to give light to the Hebrews. This light was not the natural light of a great bonfire. It was a supernatural light that illumined the night for Moses and the 12 tribes of Israel, observed by hundreds of thousands of witnesses. When Jesus took his apostles, Peter, James, and John, to the top of Mount Tabor, he made a light brighter than the sun shine forth from his body. In other words, the instantaneous manifestation from Christ's body of a light brighter than the sun was observed by three witnesses who were willing to suffer torture and death rather than deny what they had seen. On many occasions in the history of the church and in the lives of His saints, God has produced a miraculous light without any natural light source. For example, in 1453, a stolen Eucharistic host rose into the air and remained suspended amid splendid rays of light like a heavenly sunburst and was observed by hundreds of witnesses, including the Archbishop of Turin. Jesus Christ from the sacred host produced the splendid rays of light by His fiat, just as He had created the stars by His fiat in the beginning of creation. To sum up, Christians have witnessed God's production of light throughout salvation history, in the Holy Transfiguration, in the lives of the saints, and in Eucharistic miracles. But no one has ever observed a star coming into existence by a natural process, as the first stars must have done according to evolutionary cosmology. So which account of origins is more scientific? Divine creation of stars and galaxies, or cosmic evolution? let us move on to the evolution of life from non-living matter. According to the true Catholic doctrine of creation, God created life and all living things by His fiat. He spoke, and it came to be. According to evolutionary speculation, life came from non-life through billions of years of chemical evolution. When Jesus Christ went to the tomb of His friend Lazarus, Lazarus had been a rotting corpse for more than 3 days. By His word, Jesus changed the disorganized, inanimate matter of the dead man's body into the living, breathing body of His friend when He raised Lazarus from the dead. This miracle was observed by many witnesses. In His Eucharistic miracles throughout the centuries, Jesus has repeatedly brought forth life from non-life. In Sokolka, Poland, for example, a priest acting in union with Jesus pronounced the words, "This is my body," over baked non-living bread. According to the observations of two independent medical experts, quote, "The mysterious substance into which the fragment of the host had changed was muscle tissue of a human heart experiencing the agony of death as if on the point of cardiac arrest," unquote. Thus, non-living bread was changed by the words of Christ into the muscle tissue of a living, suffering human heart experiencing the agony of death. So which is more scientific, the creation of life and all living things by God's fiat, or the evolution of the first living things from non-life by a natural process? The former has been observed in the life of Christ and repeatedly in the life of His church for 2,000 years. The latter has never been observed in nature or in the laboratory. Let us continue our examination of biological evolution. According to the true Catholic doctrine of creation, God created all the different kinds of living things by His fiat. According to evolutionary speculation, one kind of creature turned into another over hundreds of millions of years. When Jesus Christ went to the wedding at Cana, by His word, He instantly changed one kind of substance, water, into another kind of substance, wine. A conversion that could never occur through a natural process, even in an unlimited period of time, took place immediately through a single act of the divine will. This miracle was observed by several witnesses. According to evolutionary speculation, one kind of creature turned into another over hundreds of millions of years through a process of mutation and natural selection. Students are told that this process has been observed in the famous long-term evolution experiment of Richard Lenski, in which several populations of Escherichia coli bacteria had been adapting to laboratory media for over 60,000 generations. The closest thing to the evolution of a new function observed in this experiment was the development by some of the E. coli of the ability to use citrate as food in the presence of oxygen. However, students are not always told that the bacteria already had the ability to transport and use citrate as food, just not in the presence of oxygen. Thus, the ability to use citrate as food in the presence of oxygen was the result of a loss of the ability to regulate a function, not the gain of a new function. It would be as if a switch broke in a car and the interior light of the car began to stay on, day and night. If someone said to the owner, "Your car's gained a new function," the owner would reply, "It's not a new function at all. My interior light has always worked in the dark, but because of a broken switch, it stays on all the time now and drains my battery." So, the Lenski experiments do not demonstrate the evolution of a new function. The acquisition of new complex organs and functions through mutation and natural selection must be happening now and must have happened trillions of times in the past if molecules to man evolution is true. But it has never been observed. On the other hand, according to the Gospel of St. Matthew, the Lord Jesus Christ multiplied 2 fish and 5 loaves to feed at least 10,000 people. By his word, the fish were multiplied instantaneously without any natural process, just as the original kinds of fish were created instantaneously by God's word on the 5th day of creation. The same miracle of the multiplication of various kinds of plant and animal food has been witnessed many times in the history of the church in the lives of the saints who prayed in the name of Jesus. In the investigation for the canonization of St. John Vianney, who died in 1859, sworn witnesses testified that when the saint blessed a small pile of wheat, a huge pile of wheat was miraculously produced in the shape of a pyramid. The same kind of miracle that has been observed again and again in the lives of the saints. So, which is more scientific? The creation of all the different kinds of plants and animals by God's fiat, or the evolution of all the different kinds of plants and animals from a one-celled organism by a natural process over eons of time? God's power to make any kind of substance out of any other kind of substance has been observed. The natural evolution of a new organ or function has never been observed in nature or in the laboratory. Finally, let us move on to human evolution. According to the true Catholic doctrine of creation, God created the first man, Adam, body and soul, by an act of his divine will. Then, he created the first woman, Eve, by an act of his divine will from Adam's side. According to evolutionary speculation, man evolved from stooped ape to upright human over hundreds of thousands of years through a process of mutation and natural selection. Evolutionists claim that this transition can be observed in the fossils, the tracks and partially mineralized bones of the ancestors of humans and chimpanzees, fossils that were allegedly laid down over millions of years. Under closer examination, however, all fossils can be identified as human, ape, or make-believe. For example, let us examine one of the most famous alleged ape ancestors of humans, Lucy. A few years ago, millions of dollars were spent on science exhibits inviting the public to meet Lucy, your ancestor. Yet Lucy's bones had been found very near to fully human footprints in Laetola, Africa. Evolutionary scientists alleged that Lucy must have made the human footprints because the date of the rock where the footprints were found was too early to be fully human. Consequently, exhibits in science museums showed Lucy with human feet, even though her foot bones had not been found. Eventually, after more careful study, even the evolution-believing scientists were forced to conclude that Lucy was a knuckle-dragging Australopithecine ape and that she could not possibly have made the Laetola footprints. In short, Lucy's expensive exhibits combined 1. Human fossil footprints, 2. Ape bones, and 3. A make-believe ape woman with human feet. But no missing link between apes and humans has ever been found. On the other hand, in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ, trustworthy witnesses testified that he healed a stooped, crippled woman to health and upright posture in an instant by his word. This miracle was observed by many witnesses. In the lives of the saints, thousands of persons and even animals have been raised from the dead in the name of Jesus. In the 15th century, the father of a certain child gave St. Vincent Ferrer lodging while he was on a missionary journey. His wife, a virtuous woman, suffered from bad attacks of nerves and at times was close to madness. Upon his return from hearing one of Vincent's sermons, the father came upon a terrible tragedy. His wife had gone mad, cut their small son's throat, then chopped up the boy's body and roasted a portion of it, which she then attempted to serve to her husband. When he realized what had happened, the man fled in horror and disgust to St. Vincent Ferrer. Vincent told him that the tragedy would be for the glory of God. St. Vincent went with the father back to the home and prayed as he gathered the bloody pieces together. He said to the Father, "If you have faith, God, who created this little soul from nothing, can bring him back to life." Vincent knelt and prayed. He made the sign of the cross over the reassembled body. The pieces became united together. The body came to life again, and Vincent handed over to the Father a living child. This event is depicted in a painting by Ercole de Roberti in the new picture gallery in the Vatican, and Bishop Ronzano claimed this as one of the miracles submitted in the canonization process for St. Vincent Ferrer. So which is more scientific? The instantaneous creation of upright humans by God's fiat, or the evolution of the first upright humans from stooped ape-like ancestors through natural processes over hundreds of thousands of years? The former has been observed in the life of Christ and repeatedly in the life of his church for 2,000 years. The latter has never been observed in nature or in the laboratory. Let us recall that science encompasses the systematic study of the physical and natural world through observation and experiment. If a scientific hypothesis does not agree with what is observed, it is not science. It is non-science. That is, nonsense. When a scientific explanation for the origins of man and the universe does not agree with what is observed, it should be called a myth or a fable. There shall be a time when men will not endure sound doctrine, but, according to their own desires, they will heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and will indeed turn away their hearing from the truth, but will be turned unto fables. Our Lord Jesus Christ said to the Pharisees of his day, "If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words?" Our Lady, Spouse of the Holy Spirit, pray for us. Amen.